House by the Tracks by Paul Ieson. Back in the day, before the white man came into this area of the country where I reside, the Seneca and the Cayuga Indians called this place the Great Black Swamp. This resides in northwest Ohio and covers 100 square miles in size. The swamp began in the vicinity of Perrysburg, and it ran as far south as Findlay and east and west from the city of Sandusky. Then nearly to Fort Wayne, Indiana, it's 40 miles wide and 120 miles long. Farmers came into this place and started to drain the swamp, and then the railroad came through. This helped greatly in clearing the swamp. Cities like Toledo started to grow bigger, and small towns started to spring up. They did this without considering the life that was here and not thinking that Mother put the swamp here for a reason. One of the only main roads out of town in the mid-1800s was Route 51 and Route 20. The village I reside in, Route 51 runs through and the railroad as well. This was key to my village even coming into existence. Where I am now was known as Clay Junction. In 1864, this place became known as Millbury. As I have told you, this area was swamp and had been for 10,000 years. This meant that the land was rich in many ways. In the case of Millbury, the land was rich in gray clay, and this is where Clay Junction came from. However, I cannot stress this enough. Things resided in the swamp that no one but the Indians knew about and still not known about till this day. The clay was used for tile for homes and in keeping the land cleared that was used by the farmers dry. Allow me to give some examples of the life that was here, but was forced to move out. The first one that comes to mind is the Ohio Grassman, aka Bigfoot, Dogman, and Shapeshifters, and the Fae, of course. When the swamp was drained, Dogman and Bigfoot moved to eastern Ohio to avoid humans, and they now live in the mountains of eastern Ohio, but the Fae remained here to this day. Where I now live in Millbury, the railroad runs right behind me. Well, there is about 4 acres of land between the tracks and my house, but you get my point. About an acre behind my house, and there is 8 acres that is swamp after that. We have all sorts of critters that live here, from deer to what you would call paranormal life. Across the street from me, there are woods as well as a big 18-acre pond. I will explain why I'm telling you this in a minute. Next to the pond, there is a house on the land as well. But it is not the original house. The original house burnt down. So, where my house sits, as well as 4 others, this land was all dug up for the gray clay underneath and then filled back in so that it could be built on. Some of the land was not filled in and became woods for a long time. After a while, it could not drain water any longer and became swamp again. The swamp behind my house is now protected land because of all the wildlife that lives there. Plans for the land across the street were to be the same, but things did not work out that way. There is an aquifer that is under the Black Swamp. That is about 40 to 50 feet down from the surface of the ground and about 50 square miles in size. It is also about 100 feet deep. As you may have guessed, everyone used the water there for their wells until recently. Anyway, while digging out the clay on the land across the street from me, they hit the top of this aquifer that at this time was 40 feet down from the ground level, and it filled up with water and is now the pond. This took place in the early 1900s. The house that used to be on the land by the tracks and the other building that used to be there was used by the business that dug up the clay. At this point in history, they still used steam engines and no one thought twice when the buildings burnt down to the ground. It was thought that the embers from the train started to fire, when in fact there was another reason. Let me take a step back for a minute. When I first moved here about 7 years ago, myself and my granddaughter were exploring the swamp behind my house. We ran across, believe it or not, the Fae. They flew all around us and allowed us to stand there for a minute and watch so that we would know who was there. They gave us time to let this sink in, what we were witnessing. When we left, I was given a warning from them. They spoke to me. The warning was about the Fae across the street from us, and the warning was never to bother them, that they did not care for humans. This took a long time to sink in for me, but I have always listened to their warning. It was after we witnessed what we did that I then cared to learn the history of this place. The owner of the land built another house on the property, but away from the tracks this time, and he let his family live there. This lasted for a while until the family became spooked and they moved and then sold the place. From what I can tell, this was in the 50s. In the 70s, the local school used a pond in winter for their hockey team. The ice was always thick enough to skate on, and the entire town would skate there at some time. However, there was at least one death every year from someone falling through the ice and drowning. People would just pass this off as one of those things at the time. No one knew any better. Time went by, and because the ice did not freeze enough to skate on, people found other things to do and forgot about the pond. Then the school no longer had a hockey team anymore. In the early 2000s, the house was sold again to a family that was a bit weird. Weird is an understatement, but it is the term that I will use here. If I remember right, it was a family of four, and all of them were a bit messed up. To start, no one in school liked the kids and they had no friends. So much so, as they sat alone at lunchtime in the school and they only had the company of each other. This was an everyday thing. And on the buses, they had to put up with constant ridicule of all the other children until they got off at home. The mother worked at the local grocery store and would only be given the worst hours to work and was given the shittiest jobs in an attempt to make her leave. The dad worked at the rock quarry in the next town over. He never had any trouble while he worked there, but people always seemed to shun him. This did not bother him because he did not like people anyway. He would just get into his truck every day and go to work, then come home. Mom had his station wagon. Then one day, shit started to happen. The mother went to leave the house in the morning and did not pay attention to whether or not anyone was driving towards her on the other side of the tracks as she went to pull out of the driveway. The driveway was almost right next to the tracks, and as she went to pull out of the drive and onto the road, she was broadsided by another car she did not see coming over the tracks. Both drivers were killed instantly. This took the family hard as they tried to come up with some reason why this happened. The kids began to get sympathy attention from the adults at school and did not get picked on as much. That is, until later. The dad, however, went off the deep end. He began drinking excessively, but this was not even the worst part. He began killing animals and placing their skulls on his fence as trophies. When the fence was full, he found other places for him. This became a daily thing for him to do. Catching and killing, and then cleaning the skulls of whatever he could catch to add to his collection. Even his children were disturbed about this, but were too afraid to say anything to him about it. The neighbors began to notice the weird activity, and then the school got wind of it and called the kids into the office, but they could not really do anything about it. But the kids ended up walking to and from school from this time after because they could not take the way that they were being made fun of by the other children. Then the day came that the father ventured deeper into the woods on his property than he had ever been before, looking for his latest catch. He didn't find an animal, but something much different. He saw a fox that changed into an eagle and flew off. Then he just stood there, trying to get a grip on what just happened. He then shrugged it off and just kept walking until he stumbled upon something else, what he interpreted to be tiny people with wings, and he just stood there with his jaw dropped. He did not know what to think because he did not believe in such things as fairies, and he could not even grasp the concept of what he was looking at. Then they noticed him, and he ran, screaming like a little child. They were the Fae Whispers. They could not allow this human to know of their home. The Fae Whispers are not evil. However, they do not put up with bullshit and they have an extreme dislike for humans. This is because humans lie, steal, and destroy anything that they do not understand. Humans take whatever they want for their own without caring who else may have it or live where the humans wish to be. The Fae do their best to stay out of the way of humans, and they never venture out beyond what they consider to be their woods during the day. So they had to back off for the moment. that had gone for years and years with no human knowing of their existence, and we're not about to let this change now. The Whispers also do not do things like steal children, nor do they act without provocation. However, are known to make deals with humans from time to time, but this almost never happens. Dealing with the Whispers is like dealing with the djinn. You just do not want to do it. The man became extremely scared and ran back into his house, locked the door, then proceeded to drink as much beer as he could until he passed out. His kids thought nothing of this when they got home because he always did this anyway. That night was to be the family's last. As they slept, the fae snuck into their house and put some things into play for the next day. Though they did not harm the children, they did put some things into the father's head. Like, if he were to harm another animal for pleasure, or just because he felt like it, that he would be forced to harm himself. It was a Saturday, so the children were sleeping in. The father awoke at the crack of dawn like he always did, and he went outside. As he opened the door, the dog yelped because he was sleeping right in front of the door. This pissed the dad off. Not that this wasn't hard to do in the first place. So he kicked the dog and cussed the dog out. Then he got the bright idea that he was going to make the dog part of his collection. He went back in the house and grabbed his gun. Then he went outside and shot the dog. This woke the kids up and they scrambled outside to see what was going on. As the kids are screaming and yelling at their dad for doing this, because they love the dog, the dad walks to the shed and grabs his chainsaw, and then the kids run back inside in fear. As this is going on, all the noise has gotten the attention of the neighbor that used to live in the house next to me. He gets dressed and starts to walk down the 300 yards to where he thinks the noise is coming from. The dad starts the chainsaw and begins to cut the head off the dog. When he does this, the children start to scream at him again, and he turns his attention to them. And they run and try to hide somewhere in the house. Their dear old dad then enters into the house with the chainsaw, making that screaming sound and yelling at the top of his lungs that they were going to get it. The kids are scared to death, and the father repeats over and over that he's tired of their shit too. He then finds the first boy in the pantry, and he slices the kid in half. Then he goes up the stairs and finds the other boy hiding under his bed. And he proceeds to push the saw straight through the bed and the child. The saw then dies, and the father gets a moment of complete sobriety and awareness. When he realizes what he has done, he then walks out of the house, bawling like a little child, and then into the front yard. A moment later, he restarts the chainsaw. Don't ask me how this is possible, but it happened. The guy completely cuts his own head off. Then there's silence. As the neighbor gets to the property, the guy who used to live next door to me, he sees the guy die, so he runs back to call the police. It is said that the neighbor was never the same after that. After everything is said and done, and the coroner removes all the bodies, the property is willed to the relatives of the family, who sell off a lot of the wooded part of the property so that they can afford to pay the taxes on a property that cannot seem to be given away. This was a big part of the land that was 1,000 acres in size and was all woods. The land was first bought by a farmer who then sold it to the city. Then it was sold to contractors who put houses on the land, and the woods that are left are less than an acre in size. The rest is the pond and the land that the house sits on. Anyway, this place remained empty for quite a few years until the memory of the past events had faded. Then someone from out of state bought the house. He completely rebuilt the inside of the house and used it as a summer home. His dad was there every day, though, until he died. However, he never spent a single night in the house because to this day, there are still freaky things that happen over there. And though he would not admit it, he was scared to. His name was Barry, and he was my friend. I would go over to the house once a week or so and see how he was doing. He would always tell me the weird shit that was going on at the house. This guy did not scare too easy since he was an ex-fireman and military. I had the chance to buy this property and still would like to have it to this day, but I do not want to pay the tax the government wants on an 18-acre pond that you can do nothing with. House by the Tracks by Paul Ieson. The end.